Good morning. In this video I will combine founder in car knowledge with dog knowledge. So this is a boat. So first of what will we tell on the topic of founder in car, more on the investment side, spreading investments. But also on the dog side, we will talk about the optimum in dog size. So first off, for example, I told about this in the founder in car series as well. If you have an asset, you can place all your eggs in one basket and go big. For example, you can buy a big house and then rent it out and get some returns on that. Very oftentimes you have to get a mortgage as a someone that hires property to get there. Or you could do it another way. If you compare that with a dog, if you have, for example, a need, let's say you have a need to deal with predators, being very big ones in animal size, or humans or smaller ones. For example, let's keep it in the animal side. You have to deal with animals of the boar type. You could go like the big house, you could go with, for example, a bully kuta, which is an enormous big dog, sometimes approaching 100 kilograms, looking like a extremely strong and capable Great Dane. Or you could go with a little bit like in the investment side, with a house, for example, 400,000 euros, if you get the mortgage right. Yes? But you could also go for smaller dogs, for example, two band dogs that weigh half of that bully kuta. And they could also deal with threats. The bully kuta, of course, when it hits the hawk, it will have a very bad time. That hawk will, because it's almost as heavy as an average hawk, especially a female hawk, and it is therefore the work, and it can have an enormous impact. But if two band dogs would attack that hawk, in my opinion, my personal opinion, I think that hawk would have at least the same troubles. And they also can easier pinpoint. For example, if the first hawk, the first dog will not have that grip on the hawk, the second can, because the first already engaged and they can work together better. It's the same with that house. You could get one big house of 400,000 euros or get two smaller ones of 200,000 euros. And that would spread your risk tremendously. Because of course, if that one house is without any trouble, you will get a lot of rent in. But if you have two houses and you do not get all the rent, you still have the other house that does. Whereas if you don't get all the rent with one big property, you still have the cost, for example, the mortgage, but you have no income. So it will be purely parasitic than on yourself. But you can even go smaller, eh? If you look at one bully kuta versus two band dogs, you could get like four bull and terriers, Irish Staffordshire bull terriers, American pit bull terriers, that size, for the same weight of that one bully kuta or that two band dogs. So instead of, for example, as I mentioned, two houses for 200k instead of one house of 400k, you could, for example, have a multiplex with four very small houses, more of a room, room plus, and get that for that same price. So that fourplex would cost the same as two smaller houses, or that one very big house. And then you still get the income, of course. In the best case scenario, everything is rented, but if it's not, everything is rented out, you will still have income from those that are rented out. And also, four voluntarians would certainly deal with a hawk very well. As I mentioned, it's the same as those two band dogs. Of course, they will be a lot weaker, but four of them, they will easily control that hawk. Even easier than that bully kuta or those two band dogs would. And then the last point, you could even go, instead of one bully kuta, two band dogs, four voluntarians, you could go with eight, the size of a petadil. And a petadil is not capable normally of handling a hawk, but if you have eight on the, of them, you have still a good chance. And there is an optimum, eh? If you go too little, it will be hard, but eight can still do a lot of control. You could do the same with this house, so one big house, or two smaller ones, or one fourplex, or eight self-storage boxes or something like that. And the thing is also, if you compare self-storage boxes to, for example, petadil terriers, they mature very quickly and they live a long life. A self-storage box, what can go wrong? It's like a concrete box. So minimum upkeep and very easy in use and reliable. The dog you see on the leash is a Boon Terrier, but that of the Petadil variety, so the smallest one. And of course there are ups and downs. I try to give you a balanced view now, but for example, if you have a garden, it could be hit and miss, eh? For example, if you have a very big garden and you have two band dogs and they are both at the opposite corners, it might take a while for the second band dog joins. Whereas if the bully kuta would engage, it would either be missing the hawk, that would be bad, I think, or it will engage the hawk, but then it is there with its full force. The same can be said if you have spread the dogs over the total field, so to say, with those other varieties. Of course, the smaller they are, the easier a hawk will deal with them one by one. But on the other hand, if you just make it a little bit, you can still have all the others chiming in quite fast. And the same with the storage boxes. If one or two get burned down, or die, so to say, in the translation with the hawks facing off with the dogs, but you still have the other ones. So, of course, you will be devastated, especially if you have such quick losses. But if fire hits a house or fire hits a storage box, the outcome is often quite the same. You cannot use them anymore, and very often the damage is tremendous. But in the storage box, in my opinion, the damage will be far less. It could be that there are some valuables stored by someone who rented, of course, but you can also insure for that. So I hope you like this little rambling.
Goedemorgen.
Ja, zeker. Hoi hoi. Another founder in car. This time we are going to bring it all together and we'll tell you how you can walk away from being an employee in a manner that is close to risk-free and become an entrepreneur. And of course, I must tell you this, being an entrepreneur is normally higher risk but also higher reward, so there is no thing as risk-free, but hear me out. What you can do is just be an employee and then learn the skills that you also want to apply once you will be self-employed, and then you can also part-time start as your own boss. So you can start your own business. Oh, we call that also in the Netherlands eenmanszaak, which will translate as a one-man business. And you can make that grow and grow, and once it is strong enough, you can also build off your job as an employee. The drawback could be, especially in some jurisdictions, for example the Netherlands, you only get a discount from the taxing department for one employer, and the employer that you have, being an employee, will go down, and the employer that you have, that's yourself, by being self-employed, will go up, and there will be a point that you pay more taxes than you would have if you would go full-fledged into being self-employed. But some people, I did this, went full-fledged in being self-employed, but some people just don't want to take the risk and don't want to burn the ships before they are sure that the self-employment ship is able to sustain them and to carry them where they want to go. And if that is you, this is a way that you can do it very gradually. Another thing you could do is being an employee and build up some reserves and then go full-fledged in being an employee, but you still have the reserves to help you cross that difficult time. Every business has normally a valley of debt, which is very steep and deep in the biotech companies. But for example, if you're a butcher, you still have to invest something, and also rent a place where you can do your things. So even a butcher or something else that's quite low key, or someone that breaks bread, you still have to invest. And there's a time that you have more money going out than going in, and you have to bridge that. So you could do this with already having some reserves from your employee job. Another thing that you could do is invest those reserves into assets and have them already in the company before you make the leap yourself to being self-employed. So you're an employee and you have some money, and that money is, for example, put into assets. A very easy example, we are now driving here on the street, you see houses. For example, you buy a house, and that house is bringing in the rent that they have to pay each month. That could be an example of an asset, but there are other assets that you could have. And if you have that, then it's also easier, because those assets will not pay the bills, but they will dampen the valley, so the valley won't go as deep as it would go normally. There are multiple options to reduce the risk. Another great option would be if you could partner with someone that already knows the tricks of the trade that you want to go in. You could bring the energy and he might bring the experience. It could also be a very good mix. So it's beneficial for both, because your amount of energy might be a lot higher than his, and his amount of experience must be a lot higher than yours, and then together you can make a good companionship. Also a partnership in the business. So that could be a good way. Another good way could even be if you have two people that are not that not that much into the direction that you want to go in together, but you both have a passion for this. There are examples that two guys bought a car and rented it out and then took it from there. And they had a passion for cars, and now they have 100 cars or more which they rent out, oftentimes executive cars or sports cars, which is a good margin of profit that you can make. And even if those two don't have the experience, when they do share the passion, two people have it easier on making it happen than just one. That's often the case, also to inspire each other again. And that's also the thing that you could do, as I mentioned before. For example, two are colleagues at work. One stays at a job, the other one starts a new business. And once the business is rolling, the other one comes in as well. That way you can both invest in a new business. And so you have more starting money. And also one has a job that's almost risk-free or has a lot less risk. And the other one is doing the more dangerous job, being self-employed, but also has the higher reward. But if you, for example, just divide the income that you get from both jobs, then you can make it happen. An easier way would be if you have a spouse. For example, you're married, but your wife has a job that is it's just reliable and will bring in the minimum amount to survive, or close to the minimum amount to survive, or even better, it can be even more. Then you can be quite free in being an entrepreneur, and just it's not a big deal, or not an incredibly big deal, if for a few months you will only invest instead of bring home the bacon yourself. So I try to give you some ways that you could approach entrepreneurship, which is high risk, high reward normally, but also reduce some of the risks associated. I hope this is helpful. Have a great day. Bye bye. Founder in car. There was some Viking tune going on. I'm now shutting it down. But that's a thing, eh? Also, the Vikings were entrepreneurs. They were one of the first to be raiding, and raiding would be, just pillaging other peoples, so for their valuables, but also sometimes for their human resources. And that was different than now. They just took them as slaves and sold them again. But they also were into making trades. So they also had trade centers. For example, Kattegat, also of the Vikings series, was a well-known trading center. So they traded, for example, all kinds of herbs, valuables, and they pillaged, but also slaves. And of course, the things that the Scandinavian countries have a lot, like animals that they killed. Also, they had their own weaponry, but they found out that the weaponry of the English had a harder type of steel than those of the Scandinavian countries. And they also, the animals that they killed had a very nice fur layers, because it's very cold in Scandinavia on average. And that's gave added the imagery of the wolves that they had, the carrying, but also other types of fur were also sold. And slaves were those that they conquered, they took some with them, and also to give them more of warriors for next pillaging rounds. The thing is, of course, the nice explorative work that they did helped them to pillage, for example, England, but also France, which was known as Francia. But also other countries, including the Netherlands, the top level of the Netherlands, Groningen and Friesland, were also pillaged. And they also made settlements there. So if you have a settlement there, it's much easier to come back and also keep you well fed and well supplied. But it is a danger, of course, because you would base a settlement in a hostile environment. The other thing is, they also, because of their explorative ways, they had a new way of navigating. They were also able to
get as far as England and France, as I mentioned, but even they made it to America. They were, before Columbus, already exploring the United States of America and had their own settlements there. Which is mind-blowing that they were there far before the westernized countries that were a little bit lower in Europe and were known as very able explorers and very able at navigating the sea, but they already did it far before that. And also another thing that I really like is that the Viking way was very hard work and also very brave. An entrepreneur needs to work hard but also be brave and risk something. And they could be brave also because they believed that if they did, even if they died, it would be in Valhalla, so to say. Yeah? And of course this is not true, but it really helped them that they had a sense, even if I die, it will be a death that is honorable. An honorable death means that I can live again or keep living. And that's also what you can believe as a Christian. If you do the right things, like Jesus told us, then we can live again. And that's mind-boggling. I lost my father 4 years ago now. And you cannot understand how much that hurts if you've never been in that position. But also if you have a hope that you could see them again, that makes it so much better in the long run. Because it doesn't need to be final. And now my mother is seriously ill. That's the same thing. It really helps. But I don't want to digress too much. But hope really helps in doing brave things. And you should always keep the hope, keep the faith. Also in your business. If you do not believe in it yourself, who will? If you do not believe in yourself, who will? So it's a good thing to keep a solid mindset and learn things also from history, yeah? Like the Vikings. They made it very far, even as a relatively small country, yeah? And they also united themselves. So it was not only the Norwegians, but also the Swedes and the Danes. Danes, have a great day. Bye bye. Another founder in car, and today we're going to talk about the KISS. Keep it simple and short, or stupid sometimes they say. But I like it to have it more of a positive vibe. And why is this important? The thing is, life is quite complex, and how much you can condense it into a simple mess gives you insight, one, about your problem solving skills, and also it can help you focus the energy that you do have into the things that do matter. Examples are there also from prominent figures that they even went as far as to go to their wardrobe and see if they could not simplify it. And what does it mean? For example, that they have the same shirt for every day, the same pants, same shoes, etc. They just have more sets of those same attributes. So one, what does it tell you? It will be very easy shopping, because once you found something that you really like, you can just buy a bulk of them. The other thing is, every day when you start your work, you don't have to think about what you're wearing a day. For me this is quite extreme, and I also like to change up your wardrobe, but I'm very effective at that, so I will be very fast in picking this. But can you imagine, even for a woman entrepreneur, this would be even more beneficial, Because women tend to take more time to decide which clothes they put on, and also even if they put them on, they are known to undress again and then put other clothes on because they think that would be better. If you then have the same clothes every day, this would be a much easier proposition. You will, one, have less time loss, that's a big thing. But the biggest thing of those entrepreneurs is they say that you only can make so many good decisions on one day, and they don't have to decide on their clothing. And the clothing is not just like an arbitrary thing, yeah, for most of us, it is, especially the guys. But you can keep one good decision in reserve for something that does matter. That's what they think. It's an interesting concept. As I mentioned, I'm not going that far myself. I like to change things up and also like to express myself through clothes. But the thing is, in general life, I don't want to focus on this wardrobe thing too much. If you can take things to their essence, you will easier understand what you're talking about. But also you're easier to translate that to another human being, for example, a client, a partner, or whatever. So that's a big benefit. The other thing is, by keeping things simple, you have less drama in your life, being personal or professional. But you also have the benefit that you can translate or convey many thoughts in a limited time frame. And you can also, because you keep it simple, you are the master of it. Eh? They say, I think it's German, durch Beschränkung zeigt sich der Meister. What that means in English, by limiting it, to make it to its essence, so to say, the master shows itself. So you will be mastering a lot more because by keeping it simple. And sometimes it takes time, right, to keep things simple. But it is a skill that will translate also to new adventures and new thoughts. And the other thing is, by keeping things simple, it's quite organized in your mind. And also the things that are not simple are a lot easier to link to simpler concepts. And the mastery will exceed. And you will be a man or a woman, it depends what you are, but I'm focusing to the men's now. You will be a man of limited words, but maximum impact. It is also very good because, for example, being an entrepreneur, we all know the elevator pitch. So in 1 minute or less, you should be able to tell your story and the interesting parts of your idea, your innovation, and how you want to bring it to the market, or how you are bringing it to the market, and where you want to go from there. Of course, there are bigger pitches in 5 minutes, 10 minutes, or half an hour. But if you are not able to do this in 1 minute, you will be lost. If you are in a C-level, so the C-suite, CEO, Chief Operating Officer, or another role, including finance and science and technology, you must be able to bring it to its essence and understand that on that level and talk to people about it and also bring the message home. The take-home messages should stick. I hope you like this little talk. I wish you all a great and a great and productive day. Bye bye.